So one of the good things about my job is I get to sit down and watch a lot of rowing footage. And some of the footage I was editing this morning was from the conference last year that we had, and John Dreesen was one of the speakers there. And one of the things he talked about, one of the questions was, have you heard of training with oars that are heavier? So like geared so they're harder to pull through and probably faster when you're training, and then when you're racing, lightening it back off. And he said that he actually does it the other way around.
So first I'll play you the bit of footage from the conference, and then I'll take you out into my boat and I'll show you how I tested them and show you the analysis of the results from that, how I found it, and what I'd recommend when doing it.
No, I do it the other way around. My opinion is to train with a slightly lighter gearing and then go back up to your racing. Why is my decision that? What do we do most of our training at? Sub rates. 18s, 20s, 22, 24. All right? So we're actually moving slower than what we need to move than in our race. But if we have a lighter gearing, we actually have to be a little bit sharper, a little bit quicker at that rate. And that transfers into our racing. So when we actually go to racing, you go to the regatta, say, but we've only done a couple of racing starts, and such. That should not be the case. You shouldn't be using, but I haven't done any race practice. Your training should be training to race every time you row. So if you're rowing with a heavy gearing and drawing really slow, then you're actually training to row slow, not training to row fast. So my advice is, train with a lighter gearing and learn how to move with that easier gearing. And then when you actually go to racing, you get the headwind effect, where you actually, I'm quick, I'm on, I'm connected, and away you go. And you're only doing it for a short period of time, so you'll be able to handle the load.
And so you're a lot more dynamic in the boat, whereas when the oars are longer, you can sort of place the blade slowly, take a big stroke, lots of weight on the legs, and tap out and you're fine. But what having a shorter oar does, it makes it so that it's a lot harder to go fast without being quick and clean. So for me especially, I was looking at some footage of me the other day rowing, and I noticed that my catch, especially at race pace, isn't very quick, it isn't very clean. My finishes also, they're drawn down into the body, they're not drawn up. And so I thought I'd try this. So basically what I've done is I've shortened my oars. So they were on 288.5 inboard, and I'm on 159 span. So I changed it, I left the span exactly the same, just changed the outboard, so the bit from the gate out to the tip of the blade. And I changed that from 288.5 total oar length to 283.5, sorry. So made my oars 5 centimeters shorter on the outside. And it really does feel quicker. You have to move more quickly. It's almost like rowing with a tailwind the whole time. So if you ever, you know, you've rowed in a headwind, it's slower, it's heavier, and you're on a tailwind, it's quicker, it's boat's a little bit less stable, and it really forces you to focus on being quick, nice quick with the legs, tapping out clean and quickly. And so I think this is a really good exercise for people who aren't quite quick enough at the change of direction. So by that I mean the catch, so changing from going forward, catch, or the finish, tap out. Shorten the oar lengths, just the outboard, so just the bit from the gate to the blade, and you'll find that the athlete has to be a lot quicker. And so when you change it back, whenever, say you might do it for a week, you might do it for a session, you might do it all through your training, and then change it back at race day, you'll feel that headwind condition. And so what I mean by that is a lot of athletes are more comfortable, myself included, rowing into a headwind. And it's because it's heavier, I have more time to place the blade, the boat moves a bit slower, I can really use my size to move the boat quite well. And so if you have it shorter, that's like simulating a tailwind. So when you go to racing, make the outboard longer, make the oars back to the normal length, so I'll take them out to 288.5. And I'll feel heavier, I'll feel more connected, And because it's only for a short period of time that I have to manage that, which most other people will be doing anyway, I'll be able to handle it for that race length. And so, but the main difference is I'll have spent all my training, well, the training up until my next race at least, working on being quicker because my oars are lighter. I'm putting less strain through my body when I'm training, so I'm less likely to load up my lower back, my ribs, you know, less likely to become injured from that perspective. So I think there's quite a few potential benefits to doing it. It almost seems counterintuitive, but if you think about, oh, I'm going to shorten my oar length so it's lighter, I move quicker, then I have to get quicker in catch, quicker out at the finish, then you really see where the idea comes together. Lots of people do resistance training, so the exact opposite. They'll put a rope out the back. And what they're really training is making their muscles stronger so that when they do place with those heavy oars, they can drive it through. It's also a very effective strategy of building strength. But if your problem is your speed of movement, so your quickness, and maybe not so much your strength, which I think mine is, like I'm reasonably strong, fitness is different. But if I'm working on speed and fitness, instead of strength, I think that that'll improve my rowing and give myself the best chance when it comes race day. But I'd be interested to see if anyone's tried this, anyone's tried it the other way around, what they think about it. Please get in touch. I just thought it was a really interesting idea and something that was well worth trying. So I'll let you know how it goes after I've had some time training along like this. I'll just give you an update at the end of the row. So I'm just at the start of the row, just done a few strokes, it feels lighter. Yeah, maybe a few minutes worth, but I'll go for my hour and a half row, come back, and I'll tell you what it feels like after that. But I can already feel myself adapting to it. It feels normal. It started off feeling a bit weird, but now it's feeling pretty normal. And so I'll just be focusing on the speed, quick pick up with the legs, nice clean extraction, and hopefully that'll force me, trick me if you will, into rowing better. So we'll see how it goes. So I just got back from my row, rowing along with the shortened outboards. And to start with, I thought, wow, this is like rowing on hard mode. Like, so the balance is a lot harder because the oars aren't as long. It means that you move around a bit more. That's also particularly the case with these lightweight oars. They come in a bit further and so the balance is a lot harder. The other thing I noticed too is I have to tap down more and lift up more. Just because there's less blade out there, it's harder for me when I lift my hand here for the blade to go in the water. So one thing I will probably do is decrease my height by maybe a half a centimeter, something like that. I think that should compensate for that effect. But when I got towards the end of the row, it, you know, I guess I got used to it. It was feeling good. The one thing I will say that felt way better than at the end of other rows that I've gone for with the longer oars is I still felt really punchy. So like, I felt really dynamic, the leg drive was nice and quick, I could just pick up each stroke one after the other, and it was nice and quick, nice and easy to do. Whereas at the end of the like an hour and a half session like that, with the longer oars, I feel like it's a bit sluggish. I have to concentrate on not pushing as hard with the legs and opening up as much, just to keep my heart rate down in the right zone. Whereas today, I realized it was a lot easier to keep that sort of punchy feeling of rowing. I'll have to check. I have the rowing in motion app on here, so I'll see if the actual stroke length, so the drive time, was any less with these oars set at a shorter distance. But I hazard a guess it's probably pretty similar. And yeah, I think the main feeling is the placing and the balance. But it does feel a little bit easier in the drive phase, so hopefully that'll be good if I can teach myself to move a bit more quickly. It feels nice. I feel relatively fresh after this session. Normally I'd feel, I think, a lot more tired, and I think it's because the oars are heavier.
So I'm just heading over to the Rowing in Motion website where they've got the analytics. So this syncs up with my phone automatically. Just have to press upload file. Okay, so here you can see, so just going to get the second half of the session just after I've worked out, you know, got a feel for the boat. So I'm going to look at the drive time here. So basically we're looking at, you know, 1.05, 1.04 seconds. That's in the water. And also see here a few of the other metrics. I'm 19 strokes a minute. So we compare that to the other one. And that's what we're most interested in at the moment, is the drive time. So go down, pick this one here. That's one with the oars at a longer distance. So pick from a similar point in the row. So we'll just get a relatively similar idea. You know, running about 18 strokes a minute, but we'll have a look. So the drive time in this one, so we're looking at, it's basically exactly the same. So, you know, that's a 1.05, 1.07 seconds. So barely perceptible difference in the actual drive, but you can see here my strokes are 18 strokes a minute. So although the actual time, drive time, is the same for both oar lengths, so with the shorter oar lengths, I'm actually comparatively quicker because I was running 19 strokes a minute yet getting the same drive time. So if I was doing 18 strokes a minute on average with the shorter oars, the drive time would be less than that 1.05 seconds. But you can see that it's a very, very similar thing. And so the main feelings you get is actually subjective with the athlete in the boat, and not so much an actual change to the profile of the stroke. If you looked at these two strokes next to each other, you'd see that they were relatively similar. Let's just have a look at the other metrics and compare them. So I'd have to say that the data for these two oar lengths is extremely similar. You can see at the top we've got the sampled strokes, 426 versus 561. You know, slightly different, but you know, it's an average of all of these strokes we're looking at, so it's a pretty good marker of if we've actually got something. We can see a change. Stroke rate, you can see, is a little bit higher with the shorter oars as opposed to just one stroke a minute. It's not really that much, but it probably reflects how much easier it felt and how it felt a bit more dynamic when I was rowing along. I'd discount the speed. It's there's been different levels of flow in the river, and it's really not a good measurement. If you had a perfectly flat area, it would be great to check out speed, but it's not in this case relevant at all. So the check delta in meters a second, this is basically the difference between the average top and the average bottom boat speed. So the idea is that you want to have your boat traveling through the water at a constant speed. That's the best way to make it most energy efficient, and you're likely to have a higher average speed. So you can see here that with the shorter oars I have a higher number, this 1.4 as opposed to 1.3. Having said that though, they're very, very close together. So the difference between the top and the bottom boat speed with the shorter oars indicates that it's slightly less efficient, but that's what you'd expect when looking at these numbers. But they're very close together, and I'd almost say it's negligible. The stroke characteristic, this is basically a measure that the app calculates an average between how much time you spend at a higher boat speed compared with a lower boat speed. And so you want a stroke characteristic that's higher than lower, but I haven't found this metric to be particularly useful when working out changes in your rowing stroke. The drag efficiency, this is basically the difference between the top and bottom speed of your boat. So if you're rowing with 97.5% efficiency, you're using 97.5% of your energy to move the boat through the water, and you're losing 2.5% to unwanted movements that aren't useful for keeping the boat at speed. And so you can see here that these two numbers are very similar, 0.1%, it's barely a difference, and it's a pretty good metric to have it at that high. Catch slope is the speed at which you accelerate the boat after the catch, so a higher catch slope is generally better. When you're racing, I've seen 80 over to 120 meters a second, because these are quite slow rows. You typically want to be picking the boat up nice and quickly, but as you can see here, it's a lot more relaxed with the shorter oars, only 29, and the longer oars, 30.5. So I was actually able to accelerate the boat more quickly with the longer oars than the shorter ones, and that might be to do with the leverage. And maybe over time, hopefully I'll have a look at my catch slope increasing with the shorter oars, to make it a little bit easier. But I think these numbers are more reflective of what kind of rows they were. The catch duration, particularly useful metric. So it's basically calculating the time from which you start slowing the boat down when you come into the catch to the point where you start speeding it back up again. And so catch duration of 0.37, identical for both the shorter and the longer oars. You know, it's pretty good. I usually try to be happy with a 0.35 catch duration, but as you can see here, there's no real difference. And if we were to look at the actual acceleration curves, you probably couldn't pick that I'd changed the oars. So, you know, having a shorter oar length, I think it's mostly subjective how it feels. It definitely plays a bit of havoc with the balance, makes it a lot harder, makes you have to concentrate a bit more. But as far as actual metrics that you can see from measurement, it's they're essentially the same in my opinion, but I'd like to see how this changes over time. It was only my first row with these shorter oars, and you know, perhaps that will change. But yeah, it's definitely interesting to see how similar the two rows actually were.
So all in all, I reckon it's a good tool for coaches to have in their toolkit when it comes to improving a rower's technique. It, I think it makes you a lot quicker. You have to be able to balance a lot better, so you're activating those core muscles a lot more. Have to tap out more cleanly and further, have to put the blade in more precisely and get the legs on more quickly. And so come race day, when I lengthen the oars back out, it should feel like easy mode as opposed to hard mode, which it's set on at the moment. So I quite like this, and I'm going to keep going for a few more sessions. I'll keep you updated on what happens, but I think it's promising idea, and it's well worth a try.